It's a big world.
Everybody can grab a seat. We ran out of time last time, so we're going to try to shotgun this thing very quick. I've got the questions that you gave me from last time. We'll start with those, and then you have another stack. What we'll try to do tonight, if you can try to limit your response to a minute, which is quick, we'll try that, and we'll alternate questions like you suggested. So I'll probably need some help reminding if you guys can jump in there. But we'll start with the first question, then the second question, third question, and just keep alternating.
If you have any questions that you want to write during the time, if you'll just hold it up, I'll be glad to come and get it and move it forward.
Okay.
Are we going to hear all the questions this time?
You're going to
well, be nice.
Just repeat it.
Oh, God.
This is the question from last time. We're going to try to get through those. And are we going to go through those?
Has anybody seen those questions?
No, they have not. They've been locked in my desk.
Okay. Lockbox.
But I did hear
Al Gore.
Al Gore
got the lockbox.
Yeah, y'all saw
ours and I did. Yeah.
Yes, you saw your stack, right?
Did you shuffle them or?
Yeah. I did shuffle them and I'll shuffle them.
Cut them.
Okay. So I'm willing to stay late, but there's some people that want to get to bingo tonight, so I'll stay as late as everybody wants. I think it'd be a great idea to get through all the questions. I know there's a lot of interest. So we'll start with a quick introduction, yes, of each candidate, if you take a minute or so. We do have one candidate that is out tonight, Nancy Tressen. Did you have something?
Okay. She was going to, but she didn't.
Okay, so Nancy Tressen is out, and J.R. Miller dropped out of the race. So start here. Go ahead.
My name is Vicki Marsden, obviously, and I'm a process systems specialist. That's like a process improvement specialist. I've been here on the island for 7 years. I've owned my house on Carrot Gulf for 5.5. What I do is I help businesses get better, and I don't sell them a product or anything like that. I don't have a magic wand either. All I have is my brain and process models to help them become better. I usually work with software companies, but I actually have a contract. Well, I've had a few contracts for the City of Corpus Christi because their engineering service department wants to get better, which is a good thing for all of us. We benefit a lot from that. And that's all I'm going to say because we're keeping this quick.
I'm Kate Walker. I've lived in Corpus Christi for 30 years. I owned property on the island for a year, lived on the island for 2 years, lived on the island for a year. I'm a lawyer. I've been practicing law for 32 years. 24 years of that, I worked for a United States judge as a briefing attorney. We're really enjoying being on the island. It's a great group of people. I have wonderful neighbors, and I just would like to help our community stay strong.
Good evening. I'm Nick Kelsey. The homeowners know my position on all the issues. I'm not going to repeat them again tonight. I have had some candidates say that I and my supporters put out misinformation. I ask you to ignore the rhetoric of all the candidates. You all know what's going on the island. You know the issues. You know who makes you angry. It has also been said that I want control of the board. I do not want control. I want to turn the board and improve its character and its mood. I want it to go back to being a board by the people, of the people, and for the people. I do not need control. As a surgeon and a senior military officer, I have more authority, control, and power than 98% of the population of this country. If you want me on this board, I will listen to you. I will talk with you, and I will do my best to carry out your directions.
You folks already know me. I'm also concerned about this
claim that we want to control the board. The truth is, Nick, Vicki, and I are committed to changing the culture of the board that bullies and blames us for speaking up against things that are unfair, unlawful, and business practices that are substandard. I don't buckle to bullies, even when I receive letters that exemplify our board's toxic attitude, wherein berating comments are interlaced with, "This is your fault. You started this. I'm accusing you and your gang of bandits of collusion." I've never so much as taken a paperclip from anyone. And we surely weren't the ones who put false statements on the POA tax returns. Perhaps Nancy, our treasurer, could enlighten us on that. We weren't the ones who voted to waive or stand so he could run in our election, even though he wasn't eligible. That was a violation of Texas State Property Code, but Leslie and Nancy voted for it. It's time to stop lambasting our members who only ask for fairness and to put the blame where it belongs.
All right, in fairness, we'll have 1 minute like the other candidates, so.
This letter was written by one of your leaders, Leslie's husband, Brent Hess. It is wholly inappropriate.
Marta,
and
you're
it is
really a private letter.
Talk about it.
Hey, hold on.
Oh, that's a joke.
It is threatening, it is violent,
Marta,
and it is inappropriate.
That's
This is why I'm running to stop this stuff. We're going to hold this meeting with respect.
That's a joke.
And we're not going to interrupt folks. You're not going to take more time than what you're allotted.
We were told 2 minutes, and it is less than 2 minutes. You changed the rules. I couldn't help that. This is not respect.
You've been disrespected left and right. You've got to be kidding me.
Is this an introduction? I don't know all the candidates.
Okay,
and I don't know where everybody stands.
So, can we move on?
Hi, my name is Leslie Hess, and I am a chief financial officer of a rehabilitation hospital. And I just wanted to touch a little bit on what I'm about, and that is probably about 2 years before I ever came on the board, there was an annual meeting, and at that annual meeting, things weren't going really well. And I'm kind of known as the rebel. I'm the one that stands up and doesn't let people bully, doesn't let people treat others without respect. And so at that meeting, I actually stood up, I waited my turn to talk, and I actually stood up and I asked all the members of the community to step back a minute, remember that we are all neighbors. We need to bring everybody together. We need to treat everybody with respect and understand that we're gonna have some varying opinions, but let's try to see what we can do. I mean, my premise is to try to figure out what we can do to bring people back together, not to focus on the negatives, not to focus on coulda, woulda, shoulda, but truly try to make it back with respect and treat people honorably.
All right, so let's move on to the questions. And again, these are from last time, and I'm just gonna go straight to them. K and JR, JR is not in the race. Why haven't you attended any board meetings in the past year?
I have attended in person one board meeting. I've watched the others online. I have. And I just want to talk some about people are saying, oh, we don't want control, we don't want control. I've also watched their forum, their candidate forum at Schlitterbahn. I watched that online. And their stated goal, they stand up and say, you need to elect three of us because the three of us, these three candidates, and Marvin combined will control the board.
Mm-hmm.
So when they say I'm just repeating what I've heard them say.
Okay, so everyone stated to effect, we need healing. We need to bring community get together. What's your plan to do this? And we'll start with you, because this is the first open question.
I'm sorry, they don't want to listen to
you. Okay, I'll read it again. Everyone stated to effect, we need healing, we need to bring community together. what's your plan to do this?
Well, one of the things that I need to, well, one of the things we really need to do as a board is be open and transparent. I think they're on their way to do that. I've seen Becky actually take action to do that. I personally hold dinners once a month and occasionally bonfires when the weather's good to try and get neighbours to meet neighbours, because I think it helps us in multiple ways. First of all, it makes it a more friendly place if you see people you know and have met somewhere, share a meal with out at HEB, and say hi. And also for some of us who are maybe single or older and infirmed, you have more contacts to help you if something goes wrong. And I think it'll help us overall in the neighborhood watch type program, where we're watching each other's houses, because on the island, we're very different to most neighborhoods. We have most of our residents don't actually live here. It's their second home. I think it's about 60% of the people do not live on the island. And correct me if I'm wrong, I think it's 60%. And that sort of makes it sort of lonely when you live here. So I try and get people together.
I agree with Vicky to the extent that knowing our neighbors and being friendly is the best way to build a bridge to each other. I'm fortunate to live on a wonderful street. We get together all the time. We look out for each other. I don't know how to make that happen. I don't know that I can ever stop some people from being caustic. I can just do my job and be independent and review every issue and make the best possible decision. And the notion that I'd be called a bully is upsetting, because for instance, just today on Next Door North, because I challenged someone's false information, I got 4 pages of diatribes against me. And so if you think that I'm being a bully, all I did was correct someone's mistake. Mm-hmm.
Obviously, all of us have basically the same idea. To heal, though, we have to talk to each other. Not that you have 3 minutes and that you're ignored. We have to have an organization that governs us, not rules us.
I think one way to heal this community is to start with responsive leadership that respects our members. That means opening meetings so that everyone can be there. It means doing a forensic audit and starting with a fresh start. It means bringing our business practices up to professional standards and letting our members be a part of the solution. That requires listening to people. That requires problem solving. It requires looking beyond the emotion, de-escalating the situation, and actually listening to people. We do that, we will be so far ahead, because I am confident in the members of this community. We can together heal this wound. Thank you.
I think one of the best ways to bring people together and unify the community is truly what the first part says, bring the people together. I mean, we look at this room right now, it's divided, and it's sad. I think that we need to have a lot more committees where we have a lot more folks come in and basically talk through what are the things that we can do. I mean, we've talked about doing a finance committee. We've talked about doing a committee that basically has fun, a fun squad of some type, whatever that would be. We need to bring those types of unity together where we get all aspects from the community to come together and sit down. It's really easy to talk about someone when they're not there. It's much harder when they're actually there and you're having open dialogue with them. And so that's what I want to encourage, is that we all sit down together and actually have some of that open dialogue together. I know I've done that with some of y'all.
All right, Kay, this will be to you. And this may be a difficult question, since you guys aren't. But if Robert's rules are followed, why does most discussion occur either without a motion or on a different topic not related to the motion? So, if anybody wants to take a shot at it.
I've never participated in a board meeting, so I don't know the answer.
I can say something to that. We don't follow Robert's rules in order, which is part of the problem, so that's the solution. start following Robert's Rules of Order. You can see lots of instances where they skipped from here and went back to there, and it's kind of been all over the place. But it would help. I think it would help for us to start following Robert's Rules of Order.
I think that we do follow Robert's Rules. We don't take it to such a stringent level because our job is to make sure that we are discussing the things that are important, that we're addressing the issues, and sometimes that is going to lead you off into other. If you're worried about everything being very rigid, we're never going to be able to have those discussions that we need to have, and some of them get heated, and that's okay, because in the end, our job is to come back together with a good solution to make it for the community.
Rebuttal, please.
One thing that has been...
Martha, it's her. It's Vicki, sir.
Okay, so I'll admit that I'm not really good on Robert's Rules and I'm on the board, but I am taking a course on April 7th as a parliamentarian, so I learn it, and I'm going to do some webinars prior to that, so I will be an expert on them. I do understand some of them. I consult a city council, to city hall, so I understand when I watch city council, I especially like the public comment part for the crazy people that turn up there, but I do need to know more, so I'm taking a course to understand it better.
All right, thank you. And was there something that was personally addressed to Marta?
Yeah.
Was it? Did you have a personal?
I have personal.
Leslie, did you address Marta personally?
Yeah.
Okay, so there is no rebuttal to
you the have, you allowed rebuttals last time.
So I'm going to go to the next question. The next question is...
This is what's rigid.
So the next question is to a candidate that's not here, so I'm going to skip these questions if they're not here. All members, what are your thoughts about why there is so much discord between neighbors, the board, and the BOA staff? What is your proposed solution? I think we've answered that one. You guys want to do it again?
Because it's really. I thought we already answered that before.
Okay. Is everybody good? Okay. Nancy Teresa, Leslie Hess. It has been almost 1 year since you formed the Compliance Committee. What changes have been made, and have the property owners been made aware of these changes?
Yes, the property owners have been made aware. Some of them were we revised the letters. When we looked at them originally that were going out, we did not feel like that they were community oriented, and so we did change what those letters were. We asked the compliance officers to back down off of some of the enforcement that they were doing, or the level of enforcement, the intensity of it, I should say. And as so far as the progress that we've been doing with the scoring, trying to come up with the scoring and stuff each month, we report at the board meeting what we're doing, what progress we've made. We've talked about that we're hoping for this next month to actually be able to do our community forum where we can put that out to the community and get some feedback on that. So I believe we have addressed it.
This next one is to Nancy Tressa, Kay Walker. In a past election, I voted for a committee with no past history of activity with the POA. I've regretted that decision. Therefore, as a apologize.
Your time is up, Brent.
Here.
It is a kind of nice or alarming.
In a past election, I voted for a committee with no past history or activity with BOA. I have regretted that decision. Therefore, as a knowledge test, can you tell us the difference between a garden lot and a patio lot and the applicable fencing and dock deck age rules for each?
Can you read that again?
No, I can't. And I know that the point of that question is to point out that I'm a little bit new to the POA and all the controversy and all the goings on. I think that's my strongest point. I don't come in here with all this garbage in the background. I'm going to take a positive approach. I'm going to look at everything.
Does anybody else, it was addressed to Kay, does anybody else want to take a shot at it? About the garden lot, patio lot, applicable fencing and deck HCC rules for each. You have 1 minute to do all this. So, anybody want to take a shot?
I don't want to waste your time.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. This one, I believe, goes to Nick first. Corpus Christi is the only municipality in the state that allows parking in front yards. These, I can't read that, realize that such parking affects property values. No other HOA in Corpus allows front yard parking. While unreasonable to remove all parking, surely we could not allow cars and trucks to park on grass, landscaping, or in rock yards. What are your thoughts on parking?
That's expensive.
Yes.
Yes, this started out as a fishing community. I think we have to allow to follow that. There, my objection is to the number of cars and vehicles that have rotted out tires. And the axles are so rusty, they'll never move again. So no, I do not want half a dozen rusty cars in somebody's front yard. But this is something that we should have the committees, the architectural committee, compliance committees, sit down, invite anyone who wants to talk about it to attend. Everyone gives their opinion, and we decide what we want it to be.
I agree. If you look at some of the houses, they're designed so that you have to park in front. There's no way around that. So I think it takes being reasonable and looking at the options and allowing our members to be a part of it. Certainly it should be reasonable. Having, I've seen it, there's a house on my street where there's vehicles parked there that don't run and are not registered, and they've got tarps over them, and they're on blocks, and they're a mess. And I think there are, oh my gosh, 7 cars parked on the lawn. That's not appropriate. So something reasonable, something fair, something consistent, I think would go a long way.
I actually agree with Vicki and with Nick and Marta here, because basically when the compliance committee reached the point for parking and they asked, are we going to address it? And we said, we're not ready to address parking. Parking is a tough issue on this island because we are a marina community. And we have some very diverse opinions from our community as to how many cars are too much. If you have a family of 4 children and 2 adults, are 6 cars too much? I agree, though, that the rusted buckets probably shouldn't be there. And so that's one of the things that I know even from the compliance committee, we said we need to go back out to the community and get a whole lot more input before we could even consider tackling parking.
Amazingly, I agree with the others. You knew I would. I'm absolutely against anything that's not registered, that's being worked on, that's a bucket of rust, should not be in the front yard. The other thing, just out of interest, that you may not know this, when they planned this community, they actually paid extra for not having footpaths or walkways. Sidewalks, so that you could have a channel gutter, so you could park with concrete or pebblecrete or something like that on there. I also agree, people shouldn't be parking on their lawn or areas like that, but if it's certainly neat and tidy and it's registered, it's your driveway, park in it.
Yeah, it's really just common sense, and you'd like to think that your neighbors respect each other enough to not junk up their yards, but it's just a reasonable standard that you should apply and deal with. But yeah, people need to park a boat trailer in their driveway. That's different from the junk cars. I think we beat a dead horse on that one.
All right. All candidates. Now that there are more volunteers willing to serve, do you support term limits for members of the board of directors? And we will start with Marta.
Absolutely. That's all I can say. Yes, we need term limits.
Absolutely. We've already been talking about it, and I believe it's a great idea.
Yes.
Yes, but I think there should be an opportunity if somebody goes off and then maybe is off for a few years and wants to come back on, then that might be a reasonable option, but term limits would be a good idea.
This is the only thing we all agree upon.
Okay, all candidates, tell me about a time when you had to confront a coworker because you felt they were behaving in an improper or unethical manner. What was the situation? What did you do?
Short story.
And that would be you, Leslie.
Talk fast.
All right, well, I'll actually use it as from my position on the board and stuff. I did have a situation where I had an individual that spoke ill of someone that was walking past. I felt very uncomfortable. I told the individual that I felt uncomfortable, that that was an inappropriate statement, and that I did not appreciate it. And we had a conversation about it. We had to finally agree to disagree. But it's just one of those things where you just have to speak up and you have to speak your mind and you have to tell people when they're being inappropriate and that it's, you know, they need to do that on their own but not in front of you.
Off the top of my head, I can actually think of the time where I had to confront someone because usually, I mean, I'm a very open person, so I talk to people all the time. I've had a lot of employees underneath me as a director of a company. If something was inappropriate, then they would be disciplined following the rules. That's about all I can think of, sorry. But
I haven't had that experience when you work for a judge. You have to be ethical, number one. There's a whole book about the canons of ethics, but therefore I've never had to confront someone else and the judge would have been the one to handle that anyway.
Kind of unfortunately, I dealt with that on a regular basis when I was military. There is an extremely rigid ethics and behavior in the military. And as a commanding officer in various units, I frequently had to tell people that they may or may not do. You don't do public statements while you're in uniform. You don't walk down the street with a drink in your hand. And you maintain respect for the people both above you and below you.
My husband, who was on ski patrol with me, can vouch for this. Occasionally, I would have a fellow patroller whose skills weren't what they needed to be, or they had an attitude that was inappropriate. And so what I would do is I would pull them aside, and then we would become partners for a while, and we would work together, and they would learn from me, and I didn't have to call them out. But it was a very effective way to teach that person what they needed to know and give them every opportunity. In businesses, I've had to fire people, but that was a last resort after multiple efforts to make things right.
Okay, next question is from Nancy. All candidates, next question. Section 12.1 of the Board of Directors, Policies and Procedures Manual directs board to conduct themselves with a high standard of personal and professional conduct. Please give us your definition of a high standard of conduct. And we will start with Leslie.
No,
was it me?
Sorry.
Back to Vicki.
Sorry, Leslie, it's me.
That's good.
I know.
Okay, please give us your definition of high standard of conduct.
Oh, I think that's doing what's right, even when no one's looking. Always be ethical and just do the right thing, most importantly.
I'd probably start with the Ten Commandments and go from there. As I said, there's the judicial ethics that I always had to operate under were very stringent. And you're right, you do what's right. I mean, how do you define that? You know it, you either know what's right and you do it, or you don't.
The ethical high standards is basically, you do never do anything that you don't want to talk about in the room. And that we should just maintain a relationship with each other, do nothing to hurt another person, and just live together as friends.
All of these are wonderful aspects of integrity, and I think another one of them is having that integrity in the decisions you make. Ask the question, not what is good for me, but what is good for the people I serve. And in medicine, it was always that way. Caring for a patient, what does that patient need? What does this family need to get through this? So it is something that goes deeper than just what I should or shouldn't do as a person. It's also what I need to do to serve the people in my community.
There's a statement made by a gentleman by the name of, I believe it's Dwight Moody. It's been my tagline for over 30 years. And it says, if I take care of my character, my reputation will take care of itself. And it's something that I just learned to live by. I've had great mentors that have said, you know, you do what makes business sense, you do what makes something right, and always, always follow the policy of whatever you do, what you say, it should always be publishable in the Wall Street Journal. And so you always think of it that way and think that whatever you put to paper, whatever you say to someone, it could be published in the Wall Street Journal. And you'll think a lot about what you say and how you say it, and you'll learn that you're treating others with that respect and the integrity that you need. So I think that's the standard that we need to follow.
Okay. Leslie, this one's addressed to you. You're in the same person who's writing multiple questions. So, and I've seen some of others. But there have been times when other board members have cut you off while providing a committee report. You say stand up to what is not right. Why didn't you insist that your committee report be heard by the board?
I think my committee report has been heard by the board. I don't think I've ever had any issues with that. Have I had people cut me off? Sure. But I've also learned that I'm not going to get in a bickering back and forth with someone. Typically, I'll let someone finish their statement, and then I'll go ahead and say what it is that I wanted to say to begin with. I just don't think that getting that bickering back and forth is a productive thing to do. I think my reports have been heard. I always, you know, if I've got something to say and I think that someone has not given me a fair shake at it, I'll have that conversation with them, but not always in public. Sometimes those conversations should occur in private, where you go back and you say, hey, wait a minute, that didn't feel so good. Can we talk about it?
Okay, this last question was addressed to JR. He's not no longer in the race, now I'm out, so I need another stick. We got about another hour, so we're doing good. We've got a lot of questions. Let's shine.
You wouldn't make people think.
No, I wouldn't.
Okay, for all candidates, I've heard that some candidates and their supporters are for adopting and maintaining all island parks. Are you for or against? And if you are for, how would we pay for it? I believe that's you.
So is it me?
So I've heard from some candidates and their supporters are adopting or for adopting and maintaining all island parks. Are you for or against? And if for, how would we pay for it?
No, I think that's the city's job. If we can work in conjunction with the city like we're doing in Village Park, that's great. If we can write grants that might give us a special needs park, I think that would be awesome. I think there's things we can do to make our parks better, but I don't think that we need to be taking care and maintaining all the parks.
I agree. Basically, we can't afford to take care of all the parks. Also, the city's responsibility should do that. The fact that they are selling parks off because they can't even afford to mow the lawn is extremely unfortunate. But I don't see how it should be our responsibility, and I have no idea we would get that much money. It's okay. I agree.
I am puzzled by something. Why do small HOAs have swimming pools and tennis courts and amenities and boardwalks and parks and all sorts of things that we're this large, large community, we don't have that. And so it is a question in my mind. On the other hand, these properties that are our parks, we don't own them. And the idea, I don't know about you, but I wouldn't build things on land I don't own, that it's just fraught with risk. So again, I would put this out to the community to say, let's have the community be part of the solution here and see what we can do creatively to maybe offer more things.
I hadn't heard that any of the candidates were taking that approach, but I don't believe that the POA should be taking on all the parks for multiple reasons. One is the cost. The other is, I would say, pretty much because we've heard from the community. Before I was ever on the board even, so I don't know all the details of it, but I've heard a lot of stories about a discussion about a community center. And the community did not support that decision, and so the board had backed down from it. So I would say that I don't think it would be something that our community wants us to take on. We do already pay our taxes, and the city does already take care of those things. We have a special circumstance of what we were able to negotiate with the city on Village Park. But as a general rule, I don't believe that that's what the community has asked us to do.
I'm not one of the candidates who supports us buying the parks, and apparently neither are any of the others, but no, I don't support that. I don't think we need to do that. I think we've got a deal with Village Park, and if we put our effort into that, along with the mums who have been able to raise some money for the playground for the children, I think that that's sort of good enough at the moment. It's the city's responsibility, and we need to lobby the city as individuals who live here.
All right, for all candidates, I've heard that some candidates and their supporters are for individual neighborhoods removing themselves from the POA. Are you for or against?
It's you.
I don't know where that came from. I don't know any candidates who wanted to have individuals withdraw the I don't think how that can be done. You would have to have each unit do it all by itself. I don't see how an individual unit could survive. I think the only way to maintain the island is for everybody to work together. I don't see how splitting us up into individuals would help in any way. So I would not support the idea of somebody withdrawing.
I've heard a few angry people in a moment of frustration say that, but I don't know of anybody who seriously wants that, and I don't see how it would work, and I wouldn't think that would be a very good approach.
It's definitely not something that I would support, but I do know that we faced it. We faced it as a board. We've received letters. We've received individuals telling us that, you know, that they want to have their neighborhood pull out of the organization. We've done what we could to try and ask them to reconsider, to rethink, to not necessarily take that approach, but instead work with us about what we can do to make it work better, as opposed to having people pull out and not work together as a community and as neighbors.
I don't support it, and I think it would be a terrible shame if they did. I think it's better to be one big community. We're just one sandbar. I think we should all come together on this. So.
Right, I think that's a bad idea. I would not support that.
All right, next one is for Nancy. She's not here. Ms. Hess and all other candidates. So we will start with Marta on this one. Will you pledge to stop using secret email votes to fund projects that you do not want the members to know about?
Man, I can be two old candidates.
An example, phase two of the Dino hurricane report that wasted tens of thousands of POA camp money. So, Ms. Hess and all other candidates, will you pledge to stop using secret email votes to fund projects that you do not want the members to know about?
I was going to say anyone who's currently on the board, that's not relevant to me.
Okay. Of course. I am all for transparency. I don't even like the having executive executive sessions at every single board meeting. It's not necessary. Those should be a rarity. So yes, I would open up meetings. I would let the community know what we're voting on and be very transparent about it.
It's easy to say we're not going to do that because our current rules don't allow us to have for secret votes. Currently, the way it works is we try to put as many of the votes as we can at the board meetings themselves. If there is something that is of a sense of urgency or of something that needs to happen during the month, then the board will pass around emails where we all openly, so everybody here sees what all the board members are saying, the board members, not openly to the public, but we talk about what it is, the pros and the cons. We may have a vote on it, an email vote, and then those have to actually be posted in the next, it's special minutes, I believe is the way that they refer to it. But anyway, it has to be in our minutes. So everything that we vote on has to go through our minutes. So there are no secret votes that can occur.
I'm not on the board at the moment, so I'm not going to comment on that. I just think we need to be transparent.
Right, again, I'm not familiar with what they're talking about, but I would be against secret emails.
Obviously against secret emails, secret meetings, and I even object to having any executive sessions in organizations of the 944. That was an extremely rare event. It's not a monthly event. To me, you go into a private meetings, executive session, you basically tell me you don't want me to know what you just talked about.
Okay, members vote for board members, then those board members vote for the officers. Who would you nominate or vote for president of the board? I believe that is Leslie. So members vote for board members, then those board members vote for the officers. Who would you nominate for president of the board?
Well, at this point, I'm not sure yet who's going to be on the board, so I can't say that, I mean, I can't make that decision yet. I mean, I have to wait and see who's interested in what positions and who ends up on the board before we make that decision.
I'm just trying to get elected. I haven't made a decision ready.
I mean, how can you say who you vote for when you don't know who's going to be there? So.
I agree. We don't know who's going to be on the board. Obviously, there are some people that will stay. Others may go. So when we find out who's on the board, we'll decide who we want to have as our leader.
Ditto.
Okay. All candidates, it's my understanding that the MMD was set up to help POA acquire loans and get FEMA assistance in the event of a hurricane. $60,000 was spent, and the information turned out to be false. What happened to our $60,000? All candidates. So,
who's me?
Who's next?
Vicki.
Me. I don't know what happened to the $60,000. I believe it was spent setting up an MMD that's actually ineffective because unfortunately they can't use it to get the grants and funds. So I don't believe that project is finished and I'm not sure what's happened with it. And I'd just like to say I wasn't on the board when they did that.
Good answer.
I don't know what transpired. I don't know. I thought I heard someone say that was done trying to get FEMA money, but we all know how FEMA is, and go ask the folks over in Rockport and Fort A how responsive FEMA is. So they might have told us we had to do it, and we did it, and then they said, sorry, we're not doing it. So I don't know, I'm not saying that's what happened, but who knows why it didn't help us.
As far as where the $60,000 went, that's a very excellent question. Yeah, it's kind of difficult to trace where the money went. I think it probably went to architects and, with all due respects to present company, attorneys to draw up the paperwork. But it is basically a useless organization. It has no assets, it has no ability to tax, and no one is going to give us $20 million of unsecured loan to fix our bulkheads. We basically gave away $60,000 and we have really nothing to show for it, except nothing.
I'm out of time.
Oh, I'm sorry. Okay.
I think the issue that we need to look at with the MMD is thinking things through before we make decisions, before we spend $60,000. It was really clear in our covenants from the get-go that we could not put our bulkheads in an MMD unless it was a taxing entity. That is part of our covenants. That was known from the beginning. So to proceed knowing that this would not work, I think was a really bad idea. And I think the community doesn't, again, there's a disconnect between the community and our leaders. And I bet most of the people out here don't even know what MMD is, or that they have a board of their own. I bet they don't even know that. I think it's time to fix the communication.
Well, none of us were on the board at the time when the MMD was formed, but one of the things I have figured out along the way is that I don't think that people wake up in the morning and say, I think I'm going to figure out how I can waste money. And I don't think that the board members that were on the board at that time, that that was what their intention was. I think that they held their board meetings. I think that they talked about the MMD. I think that looking at minutes that they discussed some options, that they were looking for some opportunities to possibly see if FEMA could help in the future. They explored what those opportunities were. Unfortunately, it did not go as far as they wanted it to. And so it's still a viable entity. It's not disbanded, but it isn't an active entity. But I really don't think that people woke up in the morning and said, I think I'm just going to figure out some way just to mess with the money. I just really don't think that.
Okay. How long have you been property owner in Corpus Christi?
Okay. Let's see. We bought our first house in 1988. We lived in various houses in Corpus Christi. Oh, sorry. 1988. I don't know. What's that? 30 years.
Yeah.
I've owned property in Corpus Christi. On the island, 2 years. Before that, 12 years in Flower Bluff. Before that, King's Crossing, Brighton Village. I've been here for 30 years.
I've been here for 9 years. I visited friends two or three times and then bought a condominium on Fortuna there. Sold that, moved on to Dos Marinas, and then Anne Marie took me in and we married, and I live on the plot now.
We've been here for 8.5 years.
All right, Brent knows that I'm terrible with years and stuff, so I'm going to do this based on the fact that my oldest daughter's 30 years old. She was in high school when we bought it, so I'm going to guess that's about 17. So I'm going to guess probably about 13 years ago, we bought our salty piece of land, knowing that this is where we wanted to come to and build on. And then we made it down here about 7 years ago.
7 years.
Right. What makes you a unique candidate for this board? What will you add that the board needs and doesn't have?
I think I'm an excellent candidate. I have been on multiple HOAs and equivalents. Before I moved here, I was on the committee for a neighborhood of about 5,000 homes. This was a historic district. We dealt with federal rules. We dealt with very expensive rules. I think I experienced doing that as far as organization with the military and with medical societies, the chairman of departments and so forth. I think I could do that well. One of the things the Navy used me for is I was a troubleshooter for them. When units had problems, they would send me in to find out what the problem was, who the problem was, and recommend to my boss, the admiral, how I think it should be fixed. So I think as a troubleshooter, I'd be a valuable person.
One of the skills that I developed over the years is evidenced by the police asking me to teach de-escalation at our next police academy, is the ability to look beyond emotion. And one of the things, it sounds crazy, I know, but I actually like people to have differing opinions on things. I like to hear both sides. I like to listen and find, because every person, I've even been with people that vehemently disagree with me, and I have seen things, truth in what they had to say. And if we can get down to that level, then we can get consensus and we can get things going in a way that's going to be productive and healthy for everyone.
It's kind of hard because I'm answering what does the board need that they don't have. Well, they have me from that perspective. Yeah. But the two things that come to mind is, one is the financial experience. Recently, we lost our accountant and our CPA. And one of the things that fell out of that was the fact that we needed to file some employment taxes. We needed to make sure that we got our year-end stuff filed, our year-end taxes paid. And so I went in, because that's what we do is we volunteer, sick or not, and poor Lisa, she had to deal with me being sick and coughing all over, but we got the taxes filed, we got the things done that we needed to get done to make sure that we were still remaining in good standing with our employment taxes. Probably didn't do everything perfectly, because it's been a while since I filed them, but I have them in my history. So the other thing that I'm known for on board, and it was most things, is I'm the mediator. I get called mom a lot, and I wind up mediating between folks that might not otherwise be getting along.
I think first and foremost is I'm a dual citizen, and I think the first Australian on the board. I can only use that for a time, but anyway, throw it out to some new people today. Okay, I think most importantly, what I bring to the board is the fact that I'm a process improvement specialist or a systems specialist, so I'll be able to help them with their processes and getting them in line. I audit against compliance to processes to make sure people are following the rules. I help them document everything from documenting them through to auditing against them to see that people are following what they said they do. I'm a good listener. I've got four daughters. I'm an excellent listener and good at conflict resolution. Okay, all four have survived and are in their 30s now. So we're good. I think that's what I'm doing.
Well, two things I'd say again. I think my lack of history is a positive because I don't have any grudges or anything. Beyond that, my experience working for a judge required me to be fair and impartial, and my job was to help him as we, in every case, listen to the evidence on both sides, and then did the research, determine to the best of our ability, the right answer. And so most of my career I've spent being fair and impartial on issues.
All right. Okay, Laura, when did... Kay Walker, when did the POA create a dual CAM fee configuration, and do you consider it fair? And I think that's open to all candidates.
I don't know. Again, right, I haven't been involved for that long.
I'm not sure when it was set up separately. I assume when it was first established, but that's older than I am. Is amazing. And as far as is it fair, no, I don't think so. However, that was the decision that was made, and that should be maintained. And it will resolve itself as houses are sold. It brings people up to the same standard, and there should be a difference between what you pay for a dry lot and a wet lot. The maintenance is different.
I think it's a tough issue, I'll be honest, because there are some people who are grandfathered, and if we changed, that would mean they'd have to leave the island. They retired here, and they've not only invested in their property that they've invested in building relationships that go on for decades. That's not an easy move. On the other hand, I greatly appreciate people who say, look, I moved in and, you know, I'm paying $1,000 and the guy across the street is paying $60. That just seems not very equitable. Again, I think it's something that will work its way out eventually. It was something done long before we were here, and I'm not sure we could change it if we wanted to. But I do appreciate it, and if there's a remedy somebody can think of, hey, tell me.
I have no idea what year or what it did. I did ask about it when I came on board to find out what was going on, and what I was told was that the community had reached a point where they needed to increase the dues. The citizens that were here were not comfortable with those due increases on them because of a lot of fixed incomes. And so in order to get the increased dues passed, what they did was create the dual system that says those that were here were grandfathered in at their rates. I believe it was at their current rates. I'm not sure if they increased or not. And then the rest of them, have, because the community was going to continue to grow and because houses would be sold and new people would come in, the new rates would be effective and eventually would eventually roll to the new rates. But that's kind of how I understood how it came to be with the dual cam system.
I'm sure that I'm going to add very much to that. I know John White was the board president. I know they went door to door together, solicit the votes to get people to agree to it. And I'm not really going to add much other than I think it is sort of unfair at the moment, but I think it's trying to be equalised. And I'd be interested in what the voters have to say about it, because I'm not sure how it will work. I wasn't grandfathered in, so.
Okay, I saw on one of the three candidates' forums that the stated objective is that by voting for the threesome, they would gain control of the board. What purpose would that serve?
Who's having a threesome?
Nick,
is it?
All right. Hey, I'm asking questions.
Can you repeat that question?
I saw on one of the three candidates' forums that the stated objective is that by voting for the three candidates who are running together, they would gain control of the board. What purpose would that serve?
Oh, me?
Yes, you.
Oh, I know, it's me. The three running together, which I assume I know who you mean, do not claim that they're gaining control of the board. The only thing we definitely want to do is to change the climate of the board, and that by changing it, we again become open. We reorganize some of our major problems. We address issues differently. And as far as being the group, we are not joined at the hip. We disagree amongst ourselves. We come to a consensus. We argue among ourselves. And we probably would continue to do so on the board, but we don't fight among ourselves.
Exactly. Actually, the point is the opposite of control, or putting the control back in the hands of the members. It's about changing the culture so that people don't feel... There's a difference between belittling people and yelling at people or whatever, and pointing out things that are not right that need to get fixed. And no member should ever be fearful of saying, hey, this isn't right, let's fix it. No member should be scorned, belittled for doing that. And so the point simply is to open up the community to everyone. And so it's not a matter of control, it's a matter of having a positive impact on the culture of your leaders.
Well, I do think from what I saw at the forums that those were words that were used of gaining control of the board. And I would encourage anybody, never ever go along those lines. A board needs to be able to basically have those really hard discussions not always agreeing with each other, but hopefully in the end, the board can come back together when it comes time for the vote part of it, and to be able to help move forward. What you don't want is a board that is similar to what we face sometimes now, where you've got all the Democrats are going to vote this way, all the Republicans are going to vote this way, and it's all party line. You don't want that for a board. No one should have that control over anything. It should be basically all the members come together, we all look at what things are, we debate as much as we want, and then hopefully we come together as a board to serve the best interest of the community.
Okay, well, I'm pretty sure that I didn't say I was going to take over the board. I don't have enough time. And I don't do a lot of running together either, because we're all getting a little bit older. I think that it's a little bit of a concern. Okay, the reason that three of us are running together on the same advertising, one was to defray the cost of it. I'm a single person. I mean, that's the truth, actually. But we are like-minded. I'm not going to say that we're not. So when we talked about it, even though we do argue about them, we don't have exactly the same beliefs about things at all, which is the truth. You know, it was sort of a way to say, well, that would defray some of the costs for me to do it, because this is not a paid position, and it's not cheap to put up signs and hand out flyers and do that other stuff, and we get along well in normal life, so that was sort of important for me. There was no talk about taking over the board, and I do support the ARCH, and I think that the voters should have the right to take over the vote.
Well, apparently there's been a change in position, because if you go watch the videos, they say that their stated purpose is to take control of the board. Mm-hmm. And go watch the ARCH videos,
yep.
Because ARCH is same, that's their same purpose. We want to take control, mm-hmm. and we're going to get this control, and then we'll do the other things we need to get done. And scorning, belittling, yeah, did I mention? Did I? Positive? I haven't seen anything positive on behalf of these people, and that you're just complete 180 degree change in what you're advocating.
Mr. Moore, that was personal. Okay. I would like to rebut that.
What?
There was no
question.
Yeah,
was he mentioning?
Nick, did you?
I thought I started this.
Okay.
I'm not the fight, but I went first to answer the question.
Okay, thanks. All candidates, if elected as a director, would you vote in favor of a motion or a resolution to amend the POA bylaws so that in the future, the bylaws could only be amended by majority vote of the POA members at a duly called annual or special meeting and not by the board? So as a board member, would you change the bylaws so the bylaws could be changed?
Better.
Okay. Am I for putting the amending of bylaws back into the hands of the members? I am. And there's a very easy way to do it, which is consistent with what other HOAs and POAs do. They have an annual review. They make the changes they need to make. It goes, the community is brought in to discuss the issues, and those issues are voted on at their annual meeting. Works well, doesn't cost a lot of money, and they are able to update their bylaws with the community's full approval, support, and input. And I think that would be a very good way to handle this.
The current wording of the bylaws indicate that the bylaws can be changed by the members. It's never been taken away from the members. There's another ability that the board can also make a bylaw change. And am I for that? Yes. And the reason I'm for it is because we do have those things. I've talked about this in the past, where you can have spelling errors, where we changed our executive coordinator to executive director, which was a unanimous vote. We make small changes, or there's changes in the law. It cost us minimum $4,000 to $6,000 every time you go out for a full membership vote. You need to hold your board of directors accountable for any bylaw changes they do make. So if they make silly ones, you need to hold them accountable and vote them out. But on the same token, don't ask to spend $4,000 to $6,000 to make a spelling error correctly.
I think that's a simple way to do it, and I believe that that's do it yearly. I don't think it would be, I think it would be ridiculous to think that you couldn't change a spelling error. I mean, you know, changing a title or changing the bylaws to say to do something else, that should be done yearly, and I think it should be done in the annual election, so it's part of the ballot, so it doesn't cost more money because you're already mailing it. I think those small things like a typo, there's no way anyone could hold an election to say, can we put an apostrophe before this S, because it's a possessive. So I think that's a bit over the top.
You know, there is nothing wrong with a board having the ability to amend the bylaws. That's been made out to be nefarious and terrible. And now again, if you go listen to Arch, they want to be able to have the power by amending the bylaws to call special meetings as often as every week. And it's just nonsense. It needs to be run like a business, and that's how we should proceed.
The brief answer is yes, I would want to return ability to change the bylaws to the members. The property code said that the members could vote to allow the board to do it. Nobody voted. We would like to have a vote to go back where we can change it. We don't have to spend money, $5,000. If things are well organized and well run, any change you do once a year at the annual meeting. As far as Arch wanting to do it weekly, I never quite heard that. Now, there has to be a time that the board does make the changes, such as changing the title for Ms. Perrine. I mean, that's a housekeeping job. Now, you can ask me, what's the definition of what is housekeeping? I think major decisions have to be done. I certainly support that we go back, and the members are the ones who control the board, the amendments rather, not that the board has control to do it as they wish.
Done.
All right, next question. All candidates, it's very telling that when the topic of a forensic audit came up, the only two candidates against that were the two incumbents, Leslie and Nancy. Why do you think a forensic audit should or should not happen?
I didn't vote for that.
And at Leslie?
Hello.
I need help.
Okay, I think you need to understand the definition of forensic audit. A forensic audit is when you believe that there is asset fraud within an organization. Someone has intentionally chosen to steal assets for their own purpose. That's the definition of a forensic audit. It takes very specialized auditors for that. There's two different types. There's one that does the investigative to identify the person, and then there's another portion of it that is actually a person who is highly qualified to go into litigation and into court and actually do all of the, be basically an expert witness. Then there's the regular audit, which is the audit of the financial statements. That's what we have, is we have a regular financial audit every single year. We've been told that we need a forensic audit, but when we ask, what is the asset fraud that you believe, what was stolen for someone's personal gain, we've never been able to get someone to come forth. A forensic audit is very expensive. So we need to understand why we need that forensic audit. What was stolen and by whom do you suspect?
All right, Leslie, can you answer the question, should it happen or should it not happen?
It should happen if we ever get concrete evidence that we believe that there is something that has occurred. We have not gotten that yet.
I believe it should happen.
If there, again, is some evidence, you know, like a forensic audit is typically done if you think you have a dishonest bookkeeper who's writing fake checks that look perfectly normal on the books, but they're cashing them to a fake company or whatever, But you don't spend the money on a forensic audit to find out if 3 years ago somebody paid $150 to somebody for a service and didn't get a receipt or didn't have an invoice to back. I mean, common sense. And if I thought that there was a need for a forensic audit, I'd be the first one to support it. But to spend the money on a fishing expedition and to float that balloon out there that we need a forensic audit because there's bad people, it's just fake news.
Well, first of all, I have to ask a question. I'm not an attorney or a CPA. If the definition of a forensic audit is that we're looking for fraud, then I don't want a forensic audit. What I want is an audit to find out where all the money is. I'm not saying anybody cheated. I'm saying that we can't do a paper trail now. I want to know. Organize our checkbook, so there's one for operations, one for various things, not a communal pot. I want to know where all our money is. I want to reorganize. I want to have it put in line items and not general categories. So if I use the term forensic audit incorrectly, no, I'm not interested in a witch hunt. I'm not going back to find out who did what. I want to find out what we have and start cleaning.
I agree with Nick. Whatever you call it, I have looked at the books. I could have torn my hair out. I have never seen a business, and this is before you, Becky, and she's done a wonderful at changing some of this. But the thing is, we need a fresh slate. We need to find out where our money is, where it's going, and figure out what we need to do to fix it. I'm not about a witch hunt either, and I'm not making accusations against anybody or anything, but I can tell you the books are messed up. There are tons of stuff missing. There are things that are there that shouldn't be there. There are things there that should, the amounts are not right. You can tell by looking at them. I've done auditing, and so I think that we need to take a close look so we can start fresh, put things away so there's no question, and we start fresh with a good system, with professional standards for accounting. That's what we're asking for.
All right. Kay Walker, you advertise positive independent leadership. Would you vote against any board member, including Mr. Moore, if you thought an idea or a motion was wrong?
What you mean within the, I'm not sure. I guess I mean within the context of a board meeting?
Yeah.
Yeah, if I thought you were wrong, I'd vote against you. If I thought you were, if I thought you were right, I'd vote for you. I mean, yes, I would vote against you if I thought you were wrong.
I can't tell. It's something about Marta at the top. If you all three are elected, who will you want to be president? Secretary?
Yes.
How would you do that?
It has to answer. Right?
Yes.
We already did that.
Okay.
I used your phrase, Kate.
Nancy Tress's absence is disturbing. Should she address the questions to her in the Moon or some other way of communicating, say email or next door?
That's just the same silly question. Oh, you want me to answer?
Yeah.
No, I don't think she should. She missed out on an opportunity tonight, so.
Right, exactly. I'm sorry she's not here. I'm sure if somebody had a specific question, she would answer it, but I don't think she should be condemned for not being here tonight. I'm sure she has a legitimate excuse.
I think the fact that she is not here says enough unto itself and the amount of meetings that she's missed. I'm here tonight. I have a board meeting of Corpus Christi Live tonight. I'm the president of that organization. At tonight's meeting, we're talking about next year's budget. And I thought this was more important than organizing and leading an entire year's program. So, yes, I had a conflict. I'm here. I consider all of you important.
Thank you, Nick. I don't know why Nancy's not here. I can't speak for her. I think that she's not here. Who can say?
No, I don't think Nancy needs to be answering questions on the other forums and stuff. I think that she needs to answer questions if somebody directs them to her. I also believe that we are all adults. We have to make decisions. We have to look at what our priorities are, and sometimes, unfortunately, we have competing priorities that we have to try and work through both of those at the same time, and it works out for us sometimes, and it doesn't work out for us sometimes. But I'm never going to condemn someone. I'm not going to try and judge Nancy.
Okay. Some of these, I'll ask you guys if you want to answer, because I think they're repeats. How do you earn the trust of others? What about people whose beliefs are contrary to your own? Can you answer that? Yes?
I pass.
Yes or no?
I'm sorry, what are you asking? Are you asking if you are going to answer the question, or are you asking me the question?
As the candidates, would you like to pass this question because it's already been asked?
Oh, it's already been asked.
All candidates, what three skills will you need to continue to develop to be the best leader you can be?
We did this when you asked about what we bring to the table.
Yeah, I think that's been answered.
Okay. This is a Nancy question. All candidates, describe a time when your integrity was challenged. How did you handle it?
He's trying to, I can't remember whose turn it was on.
I think it's yours. Describe a time when your integrity was challenged. How did you handle it?
I don't think my integrity has ever been challenged by anyone, honestly. I've made some mistakes, but certainly not my integrity, so I don't have an example. Sorry.
Oh, on next door. But other than that, I've never met.
I haven't even had one on next door. I'm going to do something.
I've never had a challenge to my integrity. I've had people disagree with me very frequently. Some of the time they were right, and I was glad they corrected me, but I never had my integrity challenged.
I would say the same, but I share with Kate in when you run for a position, people have strong opinions, and they kind of throw rocks at you some. What I do is I listen. And in this election, and I try not to, I try to sincerely talk to people, but I haven't really ever had anybody question that before.
I have to say for the whole last year, the board's integrity has been challenged on a regular basis, and on next door, it's been pretty predominant. The way I handle it is, one is I don't engage in gossip and hearsay. I try to stay out of that. I know that people who know me know that I'm an ethical person and that I strive to continue to, I may not be perfect, but I always strive to be ethical. I try to be respectful of everybody. And for those that feel otherwise, then I always encourage them to come talk to me. If you think I'm being unethical or if you think my integrity has been challenged, I encourage you to come talk to me and at least give me the opportunity to speak from my perspective what it is. Not come and attack, but literally just come and sit down and have a conversation.
Okay. Leslie Hess, the POA is a $10 million entity. We have no full-time bookkeeper, but we have a full-time compliance person. What is the thinking behind that?
It is a $10 million entity, but the majority of that $10 million is actually what is held in investment funds. Those investment funds are completely managed by an investment company. Day-to-day operation, that budget's much smaller than that. And being an accounting, having an accounting background, I know that for what the POA has, that's not necessarily a full-time job. Now, it's continuing to grow as the POA grows, and we have to look at whether or not we want to continue to increase the amount of time that we have for an accountant, but those are things that we do as we grow. And so far as the compliance, I know that before I ever came on the board, at that point, all I was hearing was, we gotta get compliance, you've never done anything about all this stuff. And so when I very first came onto the board, that was one of the things that was actually they were talking about, and so it was one of the things that happened to slide into, and that's how we wound up with a full-time compliance person.
All candidates. The POA Board Policy Manual, Section 12.01, states that all directors, officers, employees, and volunteers in the POA shall observe high standards of business and personal ethics. Please give us your definition of the term high standards. I believe your answer. Okay. This is addressed to Nancy. The next one is Kay Walker. The last candidate forum, you said you did not know what the Padre Alves Municipal Management District was.
We had that question.
When will you start learning about the POA?
We did have that.
Really? I mean, really?
I'll go read that MMD tomorrow. How about that?
This is addressed to Nancy. All candidates, do you think the present compliance program is fair to all residents? Why or why not? It's a toss-up because I don't remember who's.
I think I can answer this.
Okay.
Can you? I'm sorry.
So, all candidates, do you think the present compliance program is fair to all residents? Why or why not?
Well, I haven't been the subject of a compliance issue, so I'm not sure how it's approached. I know that there is a divergent opinion on how much or how little control compliance should have over individuals. And I think the pendulum has gone both ways, and I think it needs to get somewhere in the middle. Again, like I said, common sense, reasonableness. I really don't think I support forcing people to trim their palm trees. But just sometimes you just drive by a house and go, that looks awful. So there needs to be compliance, but it just needs to be a common sense approach to it. And I'm not sure. I guess if I'm on the board, I would want to review what all the compliance issues are and try to come up with a logical way to approach it.
All right, Nick?
No, I do not think it is fair. There are some people who have multiple complaints, and the house across the street is one step better than a junkyard. Do you think what I would like to do, we do need a compliance program, but I would like to review the organization and that anyone who wants to be on the compliance committee, we put your name in a hat, we draw the first five names at, and you're on the compliance committee. That anyone who wants to help make the rules, have an informal meeting at Island Coffee, Island Jet, or Coffee Rooms, stay on the island. And anyone who has an input, tell us what you think the compliance rules should be. And then that group of people boil it down to a few items, bring that to the board, and make that the compliance committee. We have an example where one yard got a violation letter the same day they were voted the yard of the month.
Marta?
Yes, I talked to that family that got the yard of the month and the violation letter together. Obviously, there's something wrong there. We can do much better. Some of our compliance in the past has tried to enforce the trimming of palm trees against the objection of Parks and Wildlife and experts all across the country for a whole host of reasons. And Parks and Wildlife said, I really love your approach, it's balanced. You don't tell people to trim or not to trim, you just give them the facts. It's their trees, their property, their decision. And nitpicking somebody with a code that is so stringent you can't go away for fear it'll rain and a weed will pop up is a problem.
So is letting derelict property sit there. So yeah, there's a lot of room for rate improvement.
I think the first question is it applied evenly? And I do think that it is applied evenly in the respect that I think that if we have one compliance officer, and I'm pretty sure knowing Becky that if she went out and she started attacking any single individual, Becky would probably have some serious words for her, so that it has to be applied appropriately to individuals, the same rules. So I don't think that that's going to happen. Insofar as the committee itself and what they're doing and trying to change some of that, I think that when it first came out, it was pretty aggressive. And I think that that's one of the reasons it backed down some. The committee is trying to move forward with trying to make the rules make sense. And we'll just have to kind of see how that goes when we bring it to the community meeting and see how folks feel about the work that that committee has done.
I believe we do need a compliance program. That's absolutely necessary to keep the standards up. I think it needs to be focused on the really bad stuff, first of all. Get rid of the bad stuff, fix that. Don't worry about slight weeds in people's rock garden and things like that. I think they need to focus on the big stuff. But the biggest problem with our compliance program at the moment is, I believe, when the board took back the right of the voters to change the bylaws, and the board is the one who changed the bylaws and added some things to it, and they added the palm trees, and they added unsightly objects in the yard or a new driveway and things like that. When they did that stuff, that's what got people upset about it, because they didn't have a say in it, and some of it was sort of subjective. Because I think, as Mr. Algio once said, I'm over 60, and if I'm standing in my driveway, and I'm sort of unsightly. So, which is funny. So I get there a little bit. But yeah, so it's, you know, basketball hoops in your driveway. I just think it's a little bit over the top. We should focus on the big stuff.
Okay, next question is from Nancy. Your favorite tonight, Ms. Walker. Please explain why. This is kind of a personal attack, so I'm going to skip it. I think I know who wrote it, because you've written about 12 other questions. So I'll talk with you after it and ask you if you want to ask her directly. So all candidates, give an example of the time you had to deal with conflict. Same, you guys have read that. Here's another one from the same person. Ms. Walker. You have only attended one POA board meeting and have never participated in public discussion. At the last candidate panel, you had no idea what the... It's another question. There's another question from the same person. All candidates, what do you feel are the top three qualities of an effective leader, and rate yourself on each quality on a scale of 1 to 10? 10 being the best.
We've done that.
Right? Same person. Another question. Ms. Walker. Another personal attack. I'm not going to read your questions. And I got criticized for this one time before. I've seen about 20 questions from the same person. I know who it is, and I will ask you to talk to the candidates directly. This is offensive, and this is the same thing that is on next door every day. Actually, we're out of time, folks. There's a set of questions right here. Whoever wants to stay behind, we'll have some discussions. But it's 7:30. Do we want to continue?
Sure.
Yes.
You guys want to continue? I'm good if you guys are.
Is it one per person, the question?
Actually, there's been about 20 from one person. And
I don't think anyone stated how many he could write. I didn't write a question. So
why don't we go another 15 minutes and see where they are? I'm not interested in staying here until 10 o'clock.
Yeah,
but let's go a little while.
Okay, 15 more
let's
minutes.
Let's do it in 15 minutes. Yeah,
that's fine.
I think this one has been asked, but I'm going to read through them, and you guys kind of give me a nod or not. I saw in the Arch video that they support a two-pronged approach to take control of the board by changing the bylaws and elections, electing the candidates. Do you believe this really returns power to the board as they claim? Sounds like it turns power over to the arch. I think that's been addressed, right?
It's been addressed, yeah.
All right. All candidates, do you think that a member that owns a waterfront home and pays, this is a fee question, same thing, is it fair?
It's been addressed.
All right.
It's been addressed.
Is it, so I can't read it, is it honest to say the current POA board of directors took the rights of members, stole away to change bylaws? All right, there was a question last time about background checks. There were also lots of claims by candidates regarding their experience, empowerment, education, and abilities. Are the candidates willing to publish their education and work histories?
Sure, I'll send you my resume in the morning.
Sure. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Mine's on LinkedIn.
Okay. Everybody's willing to do that. Question from Nancy.
Was that somebody said you want us to send your resumes to Ms. Corinne, or was that just we were joking? We'll do it, but I mean, did someone say they want us to right now?
So
or is that,
are you willing to?
Okay.
And
if you are, sure.
Then send them to Becky and we can put them on the website.
Okay. That was just a clarification.
Sure.
I'll send it in the morning.
All candidates, tell us about a time when something you tried to accomplish was unsuccessful. Same question, number 21.
I didn't have that one.
Okay, tell us about a time when something you tried to accomplish was unsuccessful. And I believe we're at Nick.
I think the specific things, I guess I have somebody to pick from. But I think the most interesting thing is there was some episode of an organization I belong to where I presented an idea and it was I put great amount of detail on how it was going to be expedited, implemented, and so forth. I presented it to the rest of the board. And the rest of the board said it was a great idea, but the stupidest plan they had ever heard of. thankfully, they were right. And I did not execute any stupid plan. They were smarter than I was.
I'll tell you about one time when something went really wrong. I had a patient who was on medications for psychiatric issues, and they're very hard to balance. His insurance company decided they could save $15 a month by changing his medications on him. And I fought with the medical director on a daily basis, and he would not listen to me. And so what happened, he couldn't afford his medicine, he became brittle, he lost his job, he lost his wife, he lost his newborn baby, and he tried to commit suicide by drinking antifreeze. And what I had told him would happen did. He was in ICU, in horrible pain, and I stood there at 3 o'clock in the morning holding his hand while he died because he didn't have anybody else. And I will live with that for the rest of my life. And I'm sorry that happened. I wish I could have persuaded them.
I think that my biggest thing that I've tried for and been unsuccessful at, but not willing to give up on it, is actually within this past year and stuff, and dealing with how to reach back out to our community and bring it back together. I'm not willing to give up. I still want to put it together. I have some people tell me, Leslie, it's not as bad as you think it is, but I think it is when folks, you know, come into rooms and sit in separate sides and do those types of things. I want to bring it back together. And so I haven't been successful yet. I'm going to keep trying, and I'm going to keep enlisting the help of our entire board, but I'm also going to enlist the help of everybody in this room and everybody that you know. And, you know, we get lots of grassroots campaigns trying to say, let's get out there and vote for everybody. How about if we do a grassroots campaign that says, how about if we try to come together? What can we do? Let's bring it back together.
Okay.
trying to think. I don't think that I've been unsuccessful. I haven't always won or done the right thing, but usually what I do is I tend to ask help from other people who know what they're doing, especially if I'm not an expert at it or I'm not sure about it. I know I've said some things over time, I'm not talking about here, but at work where I've come up with a bit of a plan, but I can't think of a specific instance more. I've said it and don't like it. So it really is about collaborating with other people to find the best way to do something. I haven't had any major disasters.
This is so off topic, but my sons and I showed American Quarter Horses for about 10 years, and they qualified for the Youth World Show 5 years in a row, and they never won, and it just, didn't win.
Dang. I can't ice skate either. That's the other thing I'm asking.
All right, Leslie, why did the POA's accountant resign after many years of service? And why is the POA having such a hard time finding a new local CPA?
We have the same reason with an accountant versus a CPA versus our engineering firm versus our computer firm. We are having a hard time with retaining professionals right now because they tell us that our account's not big enough for all of the accusations that are being hurled at them from members of our community. They're writing this in their resignation letters to us, and when we go out, and for the CPAs particularly, we've been turned down so many times from all of the local CPAs, or one who actually agreed to take us on, but at a horrendously high rate. It's because of all the accusations that have been hurled at them that our accounts just aren't big enough for that.
Anybody else? It was addressed to you, but anybody else want to answer or clarify?
Did you say we've lost our engineering firm? Mm-hmm.
Yes. Wow. Yes, we just got a resignation.
Who is HDR. That? You know, I have had a niece work for HDR. I know other engineers at HDR. Nothing to do with Brent. You know, that's a company that does business worldwide. They just finished the San Antonio Riverwalk project, and we lost them now. I mean, that is just incredibly frustrating to me because they are very good at what they do, and it's because of all the claims of wrongdoing. I don't blame them, but what a loss to our community that now we don't have a premier engineering firm to take care of our canals and waterways.
Anyone else? All right. I'll answer this question. I'm not running, but all candidates, these 3x5 cards are a joke. Why can't we ask our own questions? Sometimes it gets out of control, and unfortunately, this is the forum we have. Okay, Kay, what is your position on giving POA funds to schools, charities, or scholarships?
I don't think I support that. I think I said that last time. Where you choose to donate your money is a very personal decision. Most of mine goes to my church. I don't think that the POA should determine who merits that money and who doesn't. If it was something that was community-wide, like an event, maybe something consensus building fun thing, then that I could support. But just trying to decide who to give money away to is touchy, and not everybody agrees on who should get that money.
You guys take a shot at it?
No, I do not approve of giving money to charitable organizations. If they are very good organizations, but if you want to do that, do it on your own and take it off your taxes. My dues money goes to maintain the common areas. I don't think that should be given to an organization. Contribute it on your own. Don't use my money.
I agree. I think the fundamental thing here is that we made a promise to people that their money would be protected and used for the purposes we defined, and we need to live up to that. There are a lot of very worthy organizations. I've done fundraisers out here, the Shooter Eye for the police department. I see no reason why we couldn't have something in the spring or summer to raise money for the school if we want to do that. But it doesn't, it shouldn't be coming out of our funds.
I don't think that's my decision to make. I think that that is the community's decision to make. I think that we need to listen to the community, and you know, over the years, I know that there were donations given to some various organizations. There was not feedback from the community at that point in time that was not an acceptable thing to do. And so I'm not going to second guess what the previous boards have done, because again, they weren't given feedback from the community. But I do know that, just to put it out there, if you go back to February of last year, go back to the minutes themselves, when the request came in from the school for the $100,000, the minutes clearly reflect that was going to go to the community for a decision. So go back to February's minutes and you'll find it in there.
I was at the meeting. I think common area maintenance fees need to be paid for the things that they're intended for. They're not for donations. The only reason I knew about the $100,000 donation was I was actually at a meeting volunteering to help the board get better by documenting their procedures for them for free in my spare time. And that didn't eventuate. I immediately wrote an email, and in fact the only two people who responded to me were Brent, and I said, please do not vote, do not donate $100,000 to the school. And Brent wrote back and said to me that he would take them into consideration, and Leslie wrote back to me as well. And it never went out to anybody else, and I know it didn't go through, but there is also the Delmar $2,500. A year, I think it is, they donate to there. I just sort of feel that's wrong. If I want to give to them, I'd like to give to them.
Okay. Another person, Tyra. Same person.
Somebody doesn't like me.
It's doing out of game. So, good job.
You're not the only one.
All candidates. Why is the POA having such a difficult time hiring a new accounting firm? You answered that. We have a few minutes. Should the contract for the hurricane plan be paid in full, his full fee, considering the plan was not delivered in a timely fashion, i.e. before an actual hurricane? Actually, that's not true. It was delivered in a timely fashion, and he didn't control hurricanes. So, your opinion on the POA dues, we talked about that, right? All candidates at the present time, there is no open dialogue between homeowners and board members at our monthly meetings, except our 3 minutes of fame. Do you support open and public conversation between homeowners and board members at these meetings? Why or why not?
We talked about that.
Good with it? Anybody want to expand?
I have something I'd like to say. That. Yeah, actually. So even though I said I wasn't an expert on Robert's Rules of Order, I do know that the 3 minute requirement is something that's privileged to us. They don't have to give exactly 3 minutes. They also don't have to respond unless they want to tell you something that's in a procedure here, or I'll get back with you on that, but that's certainly not a conversation. I think that the POA board, one of the things that City Council does, which is, I think, pretty good, if there's an agenda item, let's say it's agenda item number 9, so now we're going to do, everyone's going to do their 3 minutes, an agenda item, and they say, if you want to speak to agenda item 9, wait and we'll let you do your 3 minutes right before it, which I think is beneficial to the board as well, because they get to sit there and hear exactly the next subject that's coming up, especially if they're going to make a vote. I think that's one thing they could do. I think the other thing is we need town halls where it's a free, something other than this for the candidates, where we actually get to talk, and not weekly or occasionally. So I think there's room for improvement.
Matt? Oh, I'm sorry, go ahead.
Kate, did you want?
No, I'm good.
I work.
When you talk about the town halls in the military, we have a thing called Captain's Call. And the way it is supposed to be played, and most captains do it, is that it is usually held someplace neutral territory, and it is understood that anyone of any rank can say anything and ask any questions of the captain. You may not be offensive, obviously, but it is agreed that you can bring up anything you want, and there will never be retaliation. Obviously, some captains don't believe in that, but generally is the rule. One of the great examples of that is a while ago, at an admiral's call, Lieutenant Junior Graves, second from the bottom of the pile, one, addressed the admiral and wanted to know why he had the ball cap rolled the way it was. And the admiral said, huh? And she says, well, my ponytail is too high. She said, can I unsnap to put my ponytail in and then snap it below the way women wear it? And the admiral said, we don't understand that. Make it so.
Just that I would like to hear more from the community. I'd like to be more dialogue so we can come to consensus. And the community, there are a lot of people with so much education and experience out here. If we can get their ideas too, I'm always convinced, like my husband and I'll come up with an idea. And then he'll have his ideas, and then when we get done, we have something better than what we started with. And so I would like there to be some avenue that we can get more dialogue going between the community and the board. I think it would help us a lot.
And I do believe that we need the dialogue with the community. I don't think that I think the 3-minute rule of the board meeting is important because of that wonderful little thing called a filibuster. And if we didn't have a 3-minute thing, those could go on forever. I have been to board meetings where we've been there till midnight. It's not fun. Everybody's too tired and you're non-productive. So I think that the 3-minute rule is important for the board meeting, but that doesn't mean that you can't have other avenues where you can talk to the board members, where we can do some town halls, where we can have that open dialogue. It's just that the board meeting is not the appropriate place for it because it's going to go too long and you're going to have folks that will filibuster.
All right, that said, I think everybody got a shot at that. It is 10 till. I appreciate you guys being willing to stay a little bit later. Thank you, everybody, for your questions. The election is March 10th. So show up, vote. Thanks again for coming out.
Starry, starry night.